Everybody got the new note packet? Chapter 9 has not come yet. Make sure you've looked at this, Chapter 9, and have it with you tomorrow, discussing the last gathering. Now, Chapter 9, this Sunday at 2:00 p.m., once again, we'll meet here. Invite you all to present, participate. Continue our analysis of last spring's 2045 Exam 2. Which we'll be able to finish without spending too much time, and then entertain any questions you may have regarding building up your muscles to be successful with Exam 2. So come prepared with questions. I'll take them on, as long as they're about chemistry. Please note the tables of valuable information, 2 and 3. One at the end of Chapter 8, one at the end of Chapter 9. At the end of Chapter 8, you'll see a list of ground state electron configurations for all atoms. So if you have any questions on writing electron configurations, you can check such. And Table 3 at the end of Chapter 9, which you just picked up, lengths and strengths of covalent bonds. Which we will begin to talk about today. In addition to what we've already talked about regarding this issue. And Page 9, 5 in Chapter 9, which you just picked up. Look, Page 9, 5. I've got a couple of typo blues. The top paragraph, you'll see a fluorine, carbon, carbon, hydrogen structure where I left out the bonds. Put in the bonds. FC single bond, CC triple bond, CA single bond. And, HC single bond, CC triple bond, CH single bond. See that? Put it in. Now look at the paragraph on electronegativity. Look at the end of the first sentence following the end. I forgot the period. Put it in. Are you seeing what I'm talking about? EN, first sentence. End of that first sentence, there is no period. Put the period in. Thank you. Now some more comments on psi strings, which we were discussing last time, and now we'll conclude that discussion. Again, for A family atoms only, the general psi strand is that as you go from bottom to top within a family, you observe a steady shrink in size. So if you want to turn it around from top to bottom, a steady increase in size. Generally substantial when you go from period to period. Sodium much larger than lithium, potassium much larger than sodium, etc. But as you go left to right, across a period trend rather than this, which is an in-family size trend, we observe a steady shrink in size, but between neighboring atoms, oftentimes there is not much size difference. Not any size difference comparable to the size difference you would observe if you look at a sodium atom versus a lithium atom. We commented on that last time. The difference in size for atoms within an A family by looking at radial probability graph A, 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s. Because those correspond to the radial probability functions for the valence electron. Hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s. Corresponding to a good difference in size between and among these atoms. And it progressively larger as you go from H to K. Now, across the period, what we're really looking at as we go across the period is a steady increase in Z effective. That's the main reason why atoms get progressively smaller as you go left to right. We did note last time that to assess size considerations, you have to pay attention to Z effective, the actual nuclear attraction felt by a valence electron. Penetration, at which S electrons are the best, followed by P, and then D, 4, and F, practically not at all. Shielding again, is most affected by core electrons. The electrons which are closer to the nucleus than the valence electron, because they're in between the valence electrons and the nucleus. They do an effective job at preventing the valence electrons from feeling a significant degree of nuclear attraction. And in this regard, size counts much more than total nuclear charge. We talked about this last time. Accounts for why the trend in first ionization energy for the atoms in the A family get progressively lower as you go from top to bottom. Lithium, more difficult to ionize than sodium. Sodium, more difficult to ionize than potassium. But in the nucleus of lithium, you only have 3 protons. Nucleus of sodium, 11 protons. Nucleus of potassium, 19 protons. Yet of these 3, potassium is the easiest to ionize, which means Z effective felt by the 4s1 valence electron, the potassium, is smaller than Z effective felt by the 3s1 valence electron, sodium. And when we get to lithium, for these 3 atoms, we have the greatest Z effect exerted upon the 2s1 valence electron of lithium. And what's the main difference between these atoms? Certainly, proton count, but that doesn't account for this big difference in ionization energy. But that is the most size. And indeed, what this is talking about is Coulomb's law. Remember the Coulomb's law expression? In the denominator, you have this d squared. So this interaction force between protons and electrons falls off as a square function of the separation distance between electron and proton. So for the larger atom, you have a much smaller, not a much smaller, but a considerably smaller attraction force acting on the valence electron compared to the smaller atom. Now more on shielding. For electrons in the same sublevel, for electrons of the same energy level, like 2s and 2p electrons, which are part and parcel of the valence configuration for the period 2 atoms after we get to boron. Boron is 2p1 and carbon 2p2, etc. As you go left past boron, including boron, all the atoms have valence 2s pair and p electrons, 2p electrons. Which electrons at an energy level are most effective at shielding? I mentioned last time it's the S electrons. They're the most stable. We'll take a look at a dramatic example of that in just a moment. And if we have electrons in the same sublevel, simplest possible case, the 2 1s electrons for a helium atom, which we talked about last time. There is a degree of shielding. Not extensive, but there is a degree of shielding. We looked last time at Coulomb's law. Hydrogen, 1 nuclear proton, 1 electron. Helium, 2 nuclear protons, 2 electrons. And helium smaller than hydrogen. Okay. If those 2 electrons for the helium atom do not interfere with each other's ability to feel nuclear attraction whatsoever, given that helium is smaller than hydrogen, helium would have a first ionization energy which is more than double that for hydrogen. Now, when we look at the values, we see that helium has a first ionization energy, which is a whole lot bigger than ionization energy for hydrogen, but it isn't as much as double. Conclusion, the helium electrons, both living in the 1s sublevel, 1s orbital, the only sublevel of energy level, do shield each other somewhat. The same can be said about a collection of p electrons in a p sublevel or d electrons in a d sublevel. Now then, let's take a look specifically at beryllium versus boron. We've noted the size trend. There are no exceptions to the size trend. Progressively smaller left to right. So, boron is smaller than beryllium. And boron has a valence d electron, which beryllium does not have. And we recognize, by examination of this radial probability graph, this is graph B, which overlays the 2s radial probability function on top of the 2p radial probability function. MPD, the most common distance from the nucleus at which you can expect to find the electron. For 2s, is longer than that for 2p. Well, that tells us that for the period two atoms, which have the electrons in the valence level, which of the valence electrons, 2s or 2p, define the size of period two atoms? Which one? Which one has, which electron type has the greater MPD? Which is it? 2s, well then, that's going to define the size of the atom. The ones which are furthest from the nucleus on a time average basis, most probable-wise, highest probability. You go to period three. In period three, once you get to aluminum, you're looking at atoms which have valence 3s, specifically a valence 3s pair, and valence p electrons. Which of these electrons, s or p, for aluminum on down to the right, silicon, phosphorus, etc., which of these valence electrons, s or p, do you think define the size of period 3s? 3s. Which one? 3s! Same idea! So why is it? That beryllium, which is larger than boron, is more difficult to ionize than boron. Why is it that beryllium is larger than boron? Why is it that beryllium is larger than boron? That's question one. And why is it that beryllium, even though it's larger than boron, is more difficult to ionize than boron? Why is it? The answer lies in this thing. And understanding what this penetration ability stuff is about. See what this picture is intending to show us? MPD 2S, much greater than MPD 2P. That accounts for the size determining property of the 2S electrons for the period 2F. But when we get to boron, how many protons in the nucleus? 5 versus 4 for beryllium, okay? And the 2s electrons are defining the size of the atom, right? Well, tell me, which set of 2s electrons, those for beryllium or those for boron, will field a greater nuclear attraction given that we're talking about 2s electrons for each atom? So they have the same penetration ability. And they're both only shielded by a 1s2 core, practically speaking. Which valence electrons, 2s for beryllium or 2s for boron, feel a greater nuclear attraction? The greater is the effect. Boron. Because in the nucleus of boron, you got 5 protons. You only got 4 in the nucleus for beryllium. Okay? Hey. That accounts for the size. Accounts for why boron is smaller than beryllium. Because as for beryllium, for boron, the 2s electrons define its size. They have the largest MPD. But they're attracted more closely to the nucleus because there's more protons in the nucleus of boron. Well, what about this ionization business? Well, tell me, when you ionize a boron atom, from a statistical standpoint, you have a choice, don't you? You can take away a 2s electron, Or you could take away a 2P electric. Well, let's imagine that we want to pursue this by experiment, because in science, that's the way to confirm something. If you do an experiment in a reliable fashion, which gives you viable results, and you find out that here's boron, that 5 electrons total, doesn't it? 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. Now then, if boron loses the p electron, minus e minus, and becomes d sigma plus, it develops this configuration, doesn't it? What if instead boron lost an electron in becoming B single plus with this configuration? How would these configurations differ with respect to properties? Specifically paramagnetic character. This is diamagnetic, isn't it? Whereas this is doubly paramagnetic, so to speak, right? This has got 2 half-filled orbitals. This has no half-filled orbitals. So we go to the lab, we generate B plus in an ionization chamber, and we make a measurement, a paramagnetic character measurement. What do you think we find? Do you think we find paramagnetic, or do you think we find diamagnetic? We find diamagnetic. So this is out. So now we know that when boron is ionized, subject to its first ionization energy requirement, you lose a 2p electron. Well, why in the heck am I losing this 2p electron when from an MBD standpoint it's closer to the nucleus? And here's the answer. See this region that I've shaded in? This represents the penetration region of the 2s electron. It's part of the 2s probability function. You remember that when we talked in brief about orbitals previously? We said a 2s orbital has 2 probability regions. If you could slice through a 2s orbital, you'd see these 2 probability regions. And this is a nodal surface. What's a nodal surface? It's a place where the amplitude of the wave function, fancy language, where the amplitude of the wave function for the orbital goes to 0. A place where you have 0 chance of finding the electron. And how is that represented on this picture? Here it is. There's our 2s node. That's this surface right here. But you've got no chance to find it. I love these electrons. And marvelous behavior. Because of wave character. Because at one instant, at any one instant, this electron, because of its wave character, is all over the place. It's all over the place. Where is it most commonly? Here. But where is it also to be found? Here, which is a much higher penetration region, all of this compared to this little part for 2p. So, we conclude that because of this greater penetrating ability of the 2s electron, which can, in effect, tunnel through the 2p electron function and get close to the nucleus, here's the nucleus, and in so doing feel a Z effective which exceeds that for 2p, we can account for why this is true. Well, enough of that fancy stuff. Question 8-9-P. You see this picture? We can use this picture to illustrate radial probability for the valence electrons of all the energy level number 2 atoms. Just look at the 2s part only for lithium and beryllium. And then we'll get the boron, where we got a single P valence electron, and then we'll have 2P2P3P4, et cetera. We add the 2P function on top of the 2S function, which I've got with this picture, which you see in the notes. Question is, if I take this graph, to be, just for fun, for boron, okay? Will the graph look exactly the same if I want to draw a graph next to it that's for carbon? How will the graph change if I draw it for carbon? How will it change? It'll go this way. And when I go to nitrogen, this way a little more. When I go to oxygen, this way a little more, right? Because what am I doing as I go from boron to carbon? I'm adding a proton to the nucleus, which means the 2s electrons feel an extended nuclear attraction, don't they? Increased nuclear attraction. Okay? And then I go carbon, more nuclear attraction, nitrogen, more nuclear attraction, oxygen, more nuclear attraction, fluorine, more nuclear attraction. And which 2s electron? For a period, two atoms feel the greatest nuclear attraction, the greatest Z effective. And account for why this atom is the hardest ionized and the smallest of the period two atoms. Which one? Neon, of course. It's just a colony for the trip. Now then. 820. We recognize that beryllium, even though it's larger than boron, beryllium is harder to ionize than boron because in beryllium you're taking away 2s electrons, whereas in boron you're taking away 2p electrons. But what if I go to carbon? Because when I ionize carbon, we're not going to recognize, certainly we're going to lose a p electron, not an s electron. But when I ionize beryllium, I have no choice but to lose an s electron because it has no p electrons. So which one of these has the higher first ionization energy? Can I decide? Can I decide on an absolute basis? Why can I not decide on an absolute basis? Do I not now have competing considerations? Beryllium versus carbon. If I ionize carbon, I lose a 2p electron. If I ionize beryllium, I lose a 2s electron. Minus 2s, b plus. Minus 2p. C plus. Which one costs more? Can I answer in an absolute fashion? Can I know for sure? Or do I instead have to go to the lab and make the measurement to find out? We have recognized, comparing beryllium to boron, it's harder to pull away the 2s electron from beryllium, isn't it? But when I go to carbon, I must take away a 2p electron on ionization. We've accounted for why? Because we recognize why it's a 2p electron loss from boron. But what's the difference, main difference between boron, between carbon and beryllium? What's the main difference? One ionizes but loses 2s, one ionizes by losing 2s, the other ionizes by losing 2p. Well, what's the other main difference? In the nucleus of carbon, how many protons?
Six.
Now I got more nuclear attraction on those 2p electrons. So what counts more? The greater Z effective experienced by the 2p valence electrons of carbon, or the fact that when I ionize beryllium, I'm forced to take away a 2s electron? How can we know? We don't know which counts more. And when scientists run into problems like this, there's only one way to resolve the issue. What is that way? Go to the lab and make a measurement. That's all you can do. And we find out that taking C plus costs more than making B plus. I can put the values down, but that's not a consequence. Because you see, what I'm driving at with this issue, which I think is marvelous about science, marvelous about chemistry, something I've heard few teachers of this stuff say. You know what the most common right answer is in science class? The most common right answer. I don't know.
That's the most common right answer.
I mean, things like the cosmos and all that, we're just beginning to scratch the surface of learning what this stuff is about. It's great. I can tell you this about science, if you choose to pursue it as a career, it's absolutely nice. It will exhilarate you all the time. It'll never bore you, but I guarantee it will often exacerbate you, wear you out, frustrate you, because you're trying to get an answer to a problem that you just can't figure out. But that's okay, because as I see it, the more research that scientists do, the more research they come to realize there is to do. This business of learning in science doesn't go like this to a point where we know everything. It goes like this, to an ever-expanding cone of knowledge. And the further you go, the more you learn, the more you will realize there is to learn. I can't think of anything more wonderful than that. So on we go. A21's easy. A21 says, which atom in the periodic system has the smallest 1s orbital radius? Which atom in the periodic system would have, for if I make this plot for 1s, would have the 1s MPD being the shortest? The atom with highest what? What do I put in here? Z! Right? Because between the 1s electrons and the nucleus, there are no shielders. Right? So whichever atom is most rich in protons is guaranteed to have the shortest 1s orbital radius. Now then, A21, cation anion size. We've talked about this already. You create a cation from a neutral atom, you observe a significant shrink in size. We've given the reasons for this previously. As opposed to creating an anion where you observe a significant increase in size. But, page 822. Let's pay attention to the size trend which we have reflected on. And look at the periodic table. If I look at the size of calcium atom, versus bromine atom, do you see in between calcium atom and bromine atom, which are both in period 4, a whole lot of atoms in between them? And as we go left to right, we're usually seeing, in general, this steady shrink in size. Now, there are aberrations for the transition metal elements, scandium, titanium, vanadium, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But still, when you add up all these small shrinks, you expect a bromine atom. If you could see a bromine atom and a calcium atom, and there were no other atoms that you could see, which one would be a good deal smaller?
Bromine atom.
All right. So now, let's add an electron to bromine, which is an electron which naturally adds an electron to become Br minus. Well, that's going to give us a big increase in size, isn't it? Well, what counts more? The fact that calcium atom is a lot bigger than a bromine atom, but when I add an electron to a bromine atom, it expands considerably. Its electron cloud becomes much larger in converting to the bromine ion. Is the bromine ion bigger than the calcium atom? Is the bromine ion smaller than the calcium atom? How can I know? This creates a real problem. Because there are ways I can approach measurement of atomic size in the laboratory. And how am I going to measure the size of an ion? I can't make an ion all by itself. All I can do is pay attention to its configuration and make a decision based on such. You know, if I could get a bromine ion all by itself and say, take a picture of it, hey, fine. But ion sizes are determined by looking at ionic lattices like this, or sodium chloride lattice, which contain anion type or types, And if I look at the size of a bromide ion in a lattice of potassium bromide, sodium bromide, cesium bromide, rubidium bromide, lithium bromide, those are five different ionic lattices, each of which contain a bromide ion. And they're all notoriously ionic materials. If I melt those materials, they're all excellent conductors of electricity. You think the bromine ion shows itself to be the same size in every one of those lattices? Heck no! Because what determines the size of an ion in a lattice is how strongly its electron cloud interacts with the electron clouds of its neighboring cations, which attract it. That's interesting and difficult. So, this is another case of something you can't really resolve. Again, I can do measurements and get a pretty good handle on the size of this. There's nothing I can do to get a handle on the absolute size of this. Can't be done. That's why I wrote in the notes. Size for these fundamental particles in chemistry is a real can of worms. It presents problems which you simply have not, at least as yet, the wherewithal to resolve. 8:22, omit. 8:23, tomorrow discussion. 24, tomorrow discussion. You better be there. 25, tomorrow discussion. 8:26, omit. You can answer that, but I don't want to bother with them. Let's go to 8:27. You will observe. Pardon me. You would observe if I gave you a table of ionization energy, which generally increase as I go left to right across the period. Because we recognize that Z effective is increasing as I go left to right across the period. And the atoms get progressively smaller as I go left to right across the period, right? But I've already seen an exception to this, haven't I? I've already found out that beryllium is bigger than boron, but it's more difficult to ionize than boron. Well, let's look at another case where the first ionization energy is non-friendly. Because based on trend, I would expect oxygen to be more difficult to ionize than nitrogen, because in each case I'm taking away a 2p electron, am I not? And the oxygen nucleus is one proton richer than the nitrogen nucleus. Well, what do I find out? This thing is easier to ionize than this. This is easier to ionize than this, and this is easier to ionize than this. What's going on here? Well, let's take a look at configurations. Nitrogen. Half-field P sublevel. How about oxygen? If I ionize oxygen to create O signal plus, minus, E minus, which of these electrons do you think goes away? You think it's this one? No. Think it's this one? No. You think it's one of these two?
Yes.
Which one of these two? No. How about this one? Okay? This one goes away, and there's O single plus. So what has happened in ionizing O atom to turn it into O single plus? I've created a half-filled P sublevel, haven't I? And a P sublevel is a package of three orbitals, so it's fairly large capacity. Remember this Gidget on D5S1 rather than D4S2 and D10S1 instead of D9S2? Same idea. And what did I get back? Because I have a pair of electrons living in the same orbit. I unpaired those electrons by ionizing the electron which we recognize that we could ionize. Right? So what do I get back? What's it called? It's called a pairing energy, isn't it? So I've generated an unusually stable half-field sublevel, and I've gotten back a pairing energy. That's enough rationale, as far as I'm concerned, to recognize why first ionization energies for oxygen, sulfur, and selenium are smaller than otherwise you would expect them to be. 828 is in regard to electron affinities. So a comment on electron affinities. Well, this is affinity mean? Liking something? You have an affinity for candy bars? I hope it's not too great. I unfortunately have a pretty big affinity for hamburgers. Ooh, I like hamburgers. Especially if I make them at home. Big, big slices of onion. If I measure the energy for this process, I will have measured the first E minus A, or some people write it this way, 4 atom A. And if I proceed, I can turn original A into a double minus ion, etc., etc. This would be the second E minus A. 4A, or the first, if you wish, E minus A for A minus, right? Tell me, what do you think about the exo-endo nature of this? Well, I don't know that you could make a reasonable decision. Because you're adding an electron to something that's neutral. Clearly, this is going to increase the degree of electron-electron repulsion in the resulting anion electron cloud. But interestingly enough, experimental measurements tell us that most atoms in the periodic table show exothermic first electron affinity. Well, let's imagine that this isn't some mythical atom A. Let's imagine that it's a fluorine atom. Would you expect this to be exothermic? Which means favorable change in enthalpy? If so, why? Why should I expect F minus? Even though I've increased the degree of electron-electron repulsion in an electron cloud, why should I expect F minus to be particularly stable? I'm adding an electron. Because it's now this, isn't it? NGS. You betcha. Now, there's a lot more to this story, so we're going to leave it at this being exo for most atoms, but not all. You will recognize, I should think, why, if I try this game, this one's endo. That seems reasonable. This one's endo. Why would you expect this one to be endo? Now, I've taken an NGS stable configuration and turned it to a much less stable configuration. Plus, in adding this electron has got to go to the next energy level, doesn't it? So it's going to feel a much smaller Z effective. Now, what about this? What can you say about a process like this? Exo-endo. Minus plus or minus? Minus, you think you're together with another minus? What do you think about that, Coulomb? Endo, repulsion. Now, what about this? Exo? Have you recognized that this E minus A electron affinity is the reverse of what? Ionization energy, absolutely. And we got a question to put to you on this, whoops, in tomorrow's discussion class. There it is, 8:30. So, I say be there. Now, one more consideration. Just so we got this trans business down. We looked at this before, but we'll look at it again, just because of the obvious similarity between ionization energy and electron affinity. They're the reverse of each other. I.e., increase bottom to top, increase left to right. He, cesium, on a relative basis, very low first ionization energy. And this has the highest first ionization energy of all atoms, which tells you that 1s2 pair of electrons is daggone stable. Now, let's, with this, take a look at E minus A. E minus A gets more, we've said, for most atoms, exo-angle. There's some exceptions to this. We'll talk about some of the exceptions in our discussion class, but in general, as I go from the bottom of the family to the top of the family, E minus A gets more. As I go left to right, E minus A gets more. Who do I put in here? X or N? I want X. Remember what we said about Z effective depending more on size and does a proton count? So do you expect lithium to gather an electron more readily than, say, cesium? Because that electron gathered by lithium will be in the same energy level as lithium's valence electrons. And much closer to the nucleus. Although I generally more exo. And this way, go left to right. Now be careful here. Over here I'm going to put noble gas atoms. Here I got fluorine. What do you think happens to this first electron affinity as they go from lithium to fluorine? Gets more? Exo or endo? Exo or endo? Am I not building Z effective as I go left to right? Doesn't that account for the general trend and increase in ionization energy go left to right? Exo, the fluorine. Because remember, F plus F minus, I mean F plus electron give me F minus, now I got NGS. But if I put the noble gases in here, they're already NGS. So what kind of first electron affinity do you expect to find for all noble gas atoms? Exo or endo?
Endo.
Endo for these guys. All right? Pick it up from this point tomorrow and start reading chapter 9, especially through the lattice energy stuff. You can do that tomorrow.